So, working capital management. So this comes up within the corporate finance study session, and a lot of the concepts within this reading should be very familiar to you. You have seen most of them before in financial reporting and analysis. So let's remind ourselves, what is working capital management? Well, or what is working capital? If you recall from accounting, working capital is, let's just get me pen up, your current assets less your current liabilities. So your current assets, you're looking at cash, you're looking at accounts receivable, you're looking at inventory, current liabilities, your trade creditors, your trade payables, and any other short-term debt that you might have. So the goal of working capital management is to ensure the company has ready access to funds, to fund the day-to-day operations of the company. But it's a fine balance, okay? We want enough cash on hand to be able to pay our liabilities as they fall due, but we don't want too much cash on hand such that the company is then not earning a decent return on that cash. So that's what this reading focuses on. How do we manage that working capital efficiently? So we start off looking at our primary and secondary sources of liquidity. So primary sources of liquidity, first of all, this is the cash that is generated from our day-to-day normal operations. So it's the cash we have on hand, cash equivalents, collections from our accounts receivable, any investment income, maybe we've got dividend income. And likewise, we could potentially borrow money. We're borrowing from our suppliers, trade credit. We might have some bank lines of credit where we're borrowing from our bank and any other short-term investment portfolios. Now, secondary sources of cash, as it says on the slide, these may significantly change the firm. If I'm generating cash from these secondary sources, we're probably in a bit of trouble. We're restructuring our debt, we're renegotiating our debt, maybe we're liquidating assets, maybe it's the worst case scenario and we are in bankruptcy and we're just liquidating assets and getting the cash from there. So factors that influence our liquidity. So when we use the term liquidity, it's the ability to turn to get our hands on cash quite quickly. So what are the factors that influence our ability to get our hands on cash quickly? Well, how effective is our cash management? The money we do have, is it all in one account earning quite a decent rate of interest, or is it all spread around different accounts earning measly rates of interest? Centralization of collections, it's much more efficient if you have if your accounts receivable is centralized as opposed to decentralized. And then we can look at the liquidity of our short-term and our long-term assets. So short-term assets, we might have invested in some T-bills that are very liquid versus long-term assets, maybe some property. Liquidity ratios are quite important. They measure the company's ability to meet short-term obligations as they fall due. And the ones you are expected to know, we've got the current ratio, the quick ratio, the cash ratio. So the current ratio we've seen before, current assets over current liabilities. The quick ratio is the same as above, but notice we are excluding inventory. So the quick ratio excludes inventory. And that's because maybe depending on what industry we operate in, our inventory may not actually be that liquid. So if your inventory isn't that liquid, then exclude it from your liquidity ratio, and what you're calculating there is a quick ratio. So cash, short-term securities, receivables over your current liabilities, and then the cash ratio, as it sounds, we're excluding accounts receivable because maybe we can't turn our accounts receivable into cash that easily or quickly either, and we're just looking at purely at cash. We then look at our turnover ratios. Again, you were introduced to turnover ratios in the financial reporting and analysis. And if you recall, turnover ratios are always an income statement number divided by the corresponding balance sheet figure. So your receivables turnover, well, that tells you what you're looking at on your balance sheet. It's your receivables. And then what's the other side of receivables? Well, it's your sales. So your numerators, your income statement, so therefore sales over receivables. And remember, on your income statement, that's your sales have been generated over a period of time, whereas our balance sheet number is at a point in time. So we're not really comparing like with like. So in order to take that into account, we look at average receivables. So if you have last year's balance sheet and this year's balance sheet, then add the two numbers together, divide by two to get an average number. Inventory turnover, so there you go, inventory on the bottom, and then the other side of inventory would be your cost of goods sold on your income statement, and then payables on the bottom, the other side would be purchases on the top. Okay, now instead of talking about turnover, it's sometimes easier to interpret if we talk in terms of days. So we can talk about our accounts receivable days. On average, how many days does it take for my customers to pay me? On average, how many days does it take me to pay my suppliers? It's just easier to interpret that information. And we can turn a turnover ratio into a days ratio by simply taking 365 divided by the turnover ratio. So you can see here, 365 divided by receivables turnover gives me my receivable days. 365 over inventory turnover gives me my inventory days, etc. So your receivable days, as I said, if this happened to be 30, then on average, it takes my customers 30 days to pay me. So in an ideal world, this number would be fairly low. I want my customers to pay me as soon as possible. Your inventory days, how long is your cash tied up in your inventory? If that, for example, is equal to 60 days, then on average, your inventory is sitting on the shelf or sitting in the warehouse for 60 days before you sell it. And then your payables days, how long does it take you to pay your suppliers? Again, that could be 40 days. So ideally, we would want this number to be quite high, because as long as my suppliers aren't charging me interest, then that is free cash. But it can't be too long. You don't want to run the risk of alienating them and them not supplying to you in the future. Now, if we know our days, we can then calculate our operating cycle or our cash conversion cycle. So your operating cycle is how long your cash is tied up in your operating assets for. So it's your inventory days plus your receivable days. Whereas your cash conversion cycle, also known as the net operating cycle, is those two, but also takes into account your payables days. So it takes into account the fact that, yes, I've got cash tied up in my inventory for 30 days, and then I've got another 30 days of receivables, but let's take into account that actually I didn't pay my suppliers for 20 days. So that reduces the amount of time cash is tied up in your working capital. And they're showing you the same thing really on this slide. So there you go. If we look at the top arrow, we're buying our raw materials here, and that's how long those, if I'm a production company, I've got the raw materials, I then need to convert them into a finished good. So those are my inventory days. When they're a finished good, I could sell them. Now, if I'm selling on credit, then it might take my customers 30 days to pay me. So that's then my receivable days up until I collect the cash. So that's your operating cycle. So I bought my raw materials here, but if I bought them on credit, then I didn't actually pay for them until this point here. So if we knock off our payables days, then actually my cash is only tied up in the business for this period here, and that's known as the cash conversion cycle. So managing our daily cash, the goal is we need to keep enough cash for routine needs, but we don't want to forego interest income unnecessarily. So if we've got too much cash on hand, then we are losing out on interest. So to determine how much cash we need on hand, then we should try and forecast our cash inflows and cash outflows by type. So sales, collections, purchases, etc. And then figure out, okay, based on that, how much cash do I need over the next few weeks, over the next 12 months, over a multi-year time horizon. So the next few weeks, short-term time horizon, should be able to forecast fairly accurately. Medium term might be a little bit more difficult. I'm going further out, and then it gets quite tricky once I'm looking at long-term horizon. if we do have any excess cash, so we've got too much cash on hand, then we shouldn't just leave it sitting there, not earning any interest. We should invest it. What should we invest it in? Ideally, short-term securities. So you're looking here at a list of money market securities, which by their very nature are very, very liquid and very safe. So you've got US T-bills, short-term federal agency securities, so maybe, you know, think Freddie Mac, Fannie Mae, etc. Bank certificates of deposit, bankers' acceptances, time deposits, repos, commercial paper. It's just a list of money market instruments that you would have seen elsewhere in the syllabus. We might need to compare one money market instrument to another, in which case I will need to compare the yields. And remember, money market's short-term, hence why we refer to these as short-term yields. And again, these are yield calculations that you have seen previously. You've seen these in quants. So we start off with calculating the discount, because some of those money market instruments are discount instruments. Some of them will have the add-on yields. So commercial paper, treasury bills, these are all discount instruments. Issued at a discount, redeemed at par. I lend 90, I get 100 back. All of your interest is accruing and you get it all back at the end. So if we can calculate the percentage discount, so it's just the difference between the face value, what you get back at the end, and the price that you've paid for it today as a percentage of the face value, then take that percentage discount and annualize it so that I can compare a 90-day instrument to a 180-day instrument. I should annualize all of these yields to make them comparable. So we're annualizing the discount using money market convention. So simple interest, 360 days. So if it's a 2% discount over 90 days, then I'm essentially taking the 2% and I'm multiplying by 4 to get 8%. All right, and I can now compare that discount to another instrument's discount and make a decision on what I should invest in. What else do we have? We've got the money market yield, which actually takes into account the holding period yield. And remember, the holding period yield is the yield based on what you have paid. So we've got the price that we've paid, and then this is our gain, or this is what we get back at the end. And then again, we annualize it using money market convention, 360 over the number of days. And then finally, we've got a bond equivalent yield, which is the same as the money market yield in that we're taking the holding period yield, but we are annualizing it, taking into account the fact that actually in real life, there are 365 days in the year, not 360. Okay, so discount basis, take the discount, annualize it, assume 360 days. Money market yield, take the holding period yield, annualize it, assuming 360 days. Bond equivalent yield, take the holding period yield, annualize it, assuming 365 days. Right, cash management IPS. IPS, investment policy statement. So a good corporate should have an investment policy statement for its cash management. What should the IPS include? Well, it should include the purpose and the objective of our investment portfolio, the strategy guidelines, the types of securities our cash should be invested in if we have surplus cash. So that's really that list of money market securities that we saw earlier. Who is responsible for managing this portfolio? What procedures must be performed if the policy isn't followed? So that's your corrective steps. And any limitations, any investments that we want to exclude because they don't meet the required credit quality or anything like that. Okay, moving on to accounts receivable. Well, a nice way of monitoring my accounts receivable is to have an aging schedule, and most corporates will have one of these. So let's say my credit terms are 30 days, so I sell goods to my customers, I send them an invoice, I give them 30 days to pay me, then I would expect the majority of my accounts receivable to be less than 31 days old. So as I can see here, then I do have the largest balance within less than 31 days, so that's good. And then we've got these debtors here that should have paid me within 30 days, but their debt is now 31 to 60 days old, so I might be getting a little bit worried now. I'm getting increasingly worried as I get to 61 to 90 days and definitely over 90 days. I'm thinking, okay, potentially these could be bad debts. Do I need to write these off? I've definitely going to get my credit control department to chase these guys up and find out why they haven't paid me. As we go from March to May, we can identify trends, and worryingly, I'm seeing the balance within less than 31 days falling here, and the balance that's owed to me for more than 90 days increasing. So I'm not liking the look of that. I don't think that's positive. So I definitely need to investigate what's going on there. Now, alternatively, we can present this information as a percentage. Probably easier to see trends if we express the information as percentages. So what we've got here, again, the same buckets, less than 31 days, 31 to 60, 61 to 90, and greater than 90. So within the less than 31 days, the average collection days are 22 days. So on average, it takes me 22 days to collect my accounts receivable here, and 40% of my total debtors are within this bucket. So that's not bad. So 40% times 22, that's where we get the 8.8 from. And then likewise, anyone within 31 to 60 days, on average, that's taking me 44 days, and we've got 30% of our debtors within there. And if we just carry on doing that, we can calculate our our weighted average collection period. Now, I would love to compare that weighted average collection period to my competitors, but that's not going to be possible. This is internal management info. It's not information that's going to be in the accounts that's going to be published. So what can I do with this? Well, I can compare it to previous years. I can try and identify trends. Is this improving? Is this getting worse? All right, so it's just ways of presenting information so management can then use that information to make decisions as to whether they need to write debts off, chase, improve their credit control, etc. Okay, evaluating performance. So there is a trade-off. So if we're looking at receivables, there's a trade-off between credit terms and sales. On the one hand, you might think, well, don't offer your customers credit terms, make them pay you cash up front, and then you don't have this liquidity issue. However, if by offering them credit terms I am increasing my sales, then yes, I'm getting the cash later, but I might be getting more cash because I have increased my sales, because I'm now more attractive because I'm offering these credit terms. So it's a fine balance. Similar idea with my inventories. You might think, okay, well, you don't want too much cash tied up in your inventory, so have quite low inventory levels, be really efficient. But then if I'm too efficient, that could lead to stockouts, customers coming to buy and I've actually sold out because I didn't have enough stock on hand. Whereas if I've got too much inventory on hand, that increases my carrying costs. I've got to pay for a warehouse manager to keep an eye on this inventory and keep this inventory secure. So again, fine balance. Likewise with your payables. You may think, well, if my supplier isn't charging me interest, then that's free money. So I will pay my supplier as late as possible. But the supplier might offer me a discount to pay early. So if I pay early, then I can take advantage of the discount, but I am giving up the potential interest on my cash, because instead of having the cash in the bank account earning interest, I've now paid the supplier. So really what I need to do is compare the cost of the interest that I'm losing out on versus the discount that I'm getting to see whether it's worth paying my suppliers early or not. As well as the fact that if I pay my suppliers too late, I might damage the supplier relationship. They might not want to do business with me in the future. That's also something that I need to take into account. So looking at sources of short-term funding, so we're in the situation whereby, okay, we've figured out how much cash we need, how much cash we have, and we've realised there's a gap, so I need to borrow some cash. Where can I get that cash from? Well, we've got a variety of sources. Lines of credit, you're essentially borrowing from your bank here. You can have a committed line of credit or an uncommitted line of credit. Now, if it's committed, so the bank has that cash set aside for you to draw down on as you need it, well, you're going to have to pay a fee for that commitment. So that's going to be fairly expensive. Revolving credit facilities are committed facilities, hence you have the fee. And really, these are available to your larger corporates, to your strongest credits. an uncommitted facility, this would be like an overdraft, I guess, and overdrafts can be, you know, they're repayable on demand, so they can be withdrawn at any moment. Well, these are less reliable because actually just when you need the cash the most, maybe you're in trouble, that's when the bank withdraws the facility because they haven't committed it to you, but there is no fee, okay? So uncommitted, it's cheaper, no fee, but therefore less reliable and could disappear when you need it the most. Commercial paper, it's a money market investment. We've mentioned it before. So commercial paper, very similar to treasury bills. So it's the corporate version of a T-bill. So it's a corporate borrowing short term. Discount security issued at a discount, redeemed at par. Really, you are, again, looking at large corporates with strong credit that have the ability to issue commercial paper. Bankers' acceptances, you'll see bankers' acceptances in the import-export world. So the scenario here is, let's say I have a German car manufacturer and we have a UK car dealer firm. The UK dealer wants to buy some cars from the German car manufacturer. Well, the German car manufacturer does not want to put the cars on the boat, on the ship to send over until he gets the cash, but the car dealer in the UK doesn't want to pay the cash until he's got the cars. So we've got a bit of a problem. The UK dealer won't pay the cash until he's got the cars. The German car manufacturer won't ship the cars until he's got the cash. So then what? We get our bank involved, and what the bank does is they essentially issue a guarantee saying that they will pay for the, they will pay the German manufacturer for the cars. So they'll get the, a little certificate saying this is the bank's going to pay them this much money in 90 days time. So they, and the idea behind it being the German car manufacturer trusts the bank more so than it trusts the dealer. And that banker's acceptance, that certificate, if you like, that banker's acceptance, that is tradable. So you can sell that and you can get cash up front. So that's one way of getting cash, trading these banker's acceptances. Factoring is to do with your accounts receivable. You've got this large accounts receivable balance on your balance sheets, your customers, they owe you money. Well, you can sell that accounts receivable to someone else, to a debt factor. Obviously, you know, there's going to be a fee, so they're not going to buy. If your accounts receivable balance is 100, they're not going to pay 100 for it. They might pay 95 for it. That's their fee for taking on the accounts receivable. But you get the cash up front and then they chase the debtors and they get the cash from the debtors as they pay. Or if you're a weak credit, you can go to these non-bank finance companies. So these distressed lenders that will lend you money, but they're probably going to charge you a ridiculous interest rate.